getting better. You know, it's the greatest sport in the world, I think.
You know, there's nothing else in the world that I'd ever want to do.
It's great. It gets in your blood, and you got to like it.
This is a life, to be in this sport. It's not to go to work and go home. This is a life.
$105,000, thank you.
40 is Kev LaBelle, New York eligible.
At the Lana LaBelle yearling sales in New Jersey, 140 future harness horses are selling for an average of $50,000 apiece. Four bid spotters are kept busy by owners and trainers who've come here from all over the country and even from abroad. Among the buyers is stockbroker Lou Guider. He's won $30 million in 8 years, making him the most successful owner in the world.
I bought one horse so far today. Hip number 39 was a Niatros colt. His name is Knight in Dixie. He's a baby, untried, untested, $105,000.
It's a huge gamble. It's just like going to Vegas or Atlantic City. I mean, that's about the chance that you have.
More than 30 countries around the world have some form of racing in harness. In North America, where over $5 billion are placed in bets every year, the sport rivals flat racing as a business.
At 265.
The Lana LaBelle farm is one of the best breeding centers in the world, and the total revenue from today's sale will exceed $7 million. All the horses are specially bred to race, either as trotters or as pacers. The trot is a diagonal gait where the hind and front legs on opposite sides hit the ground together. Although the gait is natural to horses, it takes long hours of training and great skill from the drivers to keep them trotting at racing speeds. And the slightest imbalance will cause them to go on a break, break into a canter, and be instantly disqualified. The other gait, the pace, is artificial for the horse, natural only to giraffes and camels. It's a lateral gait where hind and front legs on the same side come down together, enabling the horse to travel slightly faster than at a trot. Indeed, top pacers reach speeds of 35 miles an hour, almost as fast as a thoroughbred can gallop. Horses which have been bred to pace often do so as youngsters in the field before they have ever seen a harness. But most of them wear leather hobbles, attaching both legs on the same side to prevent them from breaking pace. In Europe, there are very few pacers, but in America, they represent 80% of the horses racing today. Trainers usually stick to either trotters or pacers, although drivers will work with both. Double-gated horses are extremely rare. Nowadays, the big races all use the mobile starting gate, which allows the horses to line up whilst on the move. The car does not wait for the horses. It's up to the driver to get his horse as close as possible to the car as it crosses the starting line. The barrier placings are drawn before the race. But once they're off, the drivers vie for the best positions, aiming for the inside rail without getting boxed in. A horse is parked out if he can't get to the rail. If he's up front and still on the outside, he's in the death seat. Every driver must know the abilities of the other runners, and it is said that the greatest skill in racing lies in gauging exactly when to make your run. Most horses, whether sprinters or stayers, have an extra burst of speed in them. The trick is knowing how and when to turn it on.
Mm-hmm.
The Meadowlands Racetrack, New York, August. Crowds of around 32,000 are arriving for the most prestigious race of the harness racing year, the Hambletonian for three-year-old male trotters. The Hambletonian is said by many to be the toughest horse race of all, harder to win than the Grand National or the Derby. The horses are divided into two heats, and to win the title, a horse must run two, if not three, races on the same afternoon. From November up till August, the top trotters in the country, and even some from abroad, have been training to peak for this million-dollar race.
In America, you know, it's the number one race. If you ask any driver, trainer, owner, what race they want to win, it's the Hambletonian.
Harness racing is usually a night sport, but the Hambletonian is held at midday, and the August heat will add to the toughness of the race. In North America alone, $400 million are awarded in prizes every year, and the winner of the Hambletonian gets $500,000, split 90% to the owner and 5% each to trainer and driver. John Campbell, driver of the favorite today, is one of three men who've topped $50 million in career winnings.
I've made over $54 million in purses. I've been very fortunate with the money, but I would be doing something in harness racing, but I couldn't drive. I'd be training for somebody else or working with them somehow. So it's more than money that lures you to it.
John Campbell is probably, right now, is the leading driver in the country in America. And, you know, he's just fortunate that he's able to get along with each and every horse that he drives.
John Campbell is just a talented man. I just can't explain it. He's like a great artist. He's poetry in motion.
He doesn't have to warm up a horse. The very first time he gets on a horse, just by scoring him down once, he gets the feel of the horse.
John Campbell's Hambletonian runner is trained in the stables of Chuck Sylvester and is something of a phenomenon. Bought as a yearling from the Lana LaBelle farms by Lou Guider for a bargain price of $17,000, the stallion Mac LaBelle looks set to be one of the greatest trotters this century has seen.
I had no idea that he was going to be the horse that he is. As a matter of fact, I bought a lot more expensive horses that I thought would be better than him. But he fit into my plans, but I had no idea that he would be this good. And there was nothing special about him as a yearling. I just loved Mystic Park, and I wanted to buy one of his sons.
Mystic Park, Mac LaBelle's sire, was an exceptional trotter. But he broke stride in his bid for the Hambletonian as a three-year-old and was retired to stud. Then he came down with Potomac fever and foundered. Two of his hooves fell off, and the other two had to be surgically removed. Any normal horse in this state would have been put down, but Mystic Park's insurance had somehow been forgotten, and the project Save Mystic Park was begun. For 6 months, the horse, unable to stand, was turned from side to side by his mane, or hung in a sling and lowered into a swimming pool. Slowly, his hooves grew back, and his recovery was celebrated at Halloween by dressing him up as a unicorn and feeding him cake and champagne.
Well, he does have a fighting spirit. It's a miracle he is alive. Grew all 4 feet back. He is potentially very healthy. He's one heck of an animal.
Mac LaBelle was from Mystic Park's first crop of foals.
Mac LaBelle is a great animal. He's a thrill for me to drive. He just does everything you have asked him so far this year. We're hoping he does today. He's the best horse that I've ever driven. He's got tremendous athletic ability, and his manners are impeccable. If we can stay away from bad racing luck, he's going to be awful hard to beat.
He's just developed into an exceptional horse. He just has more ability than any horse I've ever been around.
Perhaps surprisingly, neither Chuck Sylvester, John Campbell, nor Lou Guider have ever won the Hambletonian before. Mac LaBelle goes into the first heat as odds-on favorite, at 1-20. The other drivers know that this is the horse to beat.
And here they come for the first division of the first heat of the Hambletonian, and they're off. And Mac LaBelle is out quickly for the lead from the outside, and Sir Torres is moving with him early. And Besieged is out fast toward the rail. The field rounds the first turn, and it's Sir Torres who's up for the lead. Mac LaBelle was three wide in the early going, and John Campbell's looking for the lead with him now. And the opening quarter was quick, 27-4. And they move into the back stretch, and Mac LaBelle powers up to take the lead now. The three-quarter mark was 1:26 flat, and it's Mac LaBelle, the leader at the top of the stretch by a length and a half. John Campbell driving him confidently with an eighth of a mile to come. Spotlight LaBelle is full out to try to get him. Then farther back, Besieged is racing third. On the inside, Sir Torres is fourth. Mac LaBelle impressive here, and he's pulling away with the field with complete authority. Mac LaBelle has won it by five widening lengths, and the time was 1:54 flat. That is a Hambo record, and it ties the track record.
In the second heat, the favorite is Napolitano, driven by Bill O'Donnell, who's won over 10 million in a single season and is known as the magic man for his knack of winning races with any horse.
It's not magical ability, it's horse sense, you know, growing up around him and just kind of thinking like a horse sometimes.
And they're off, and Crown Sweep is on a break as the field moves for the first turn, and Cotton Hanover, with a quick early move, angles over to the inside to grab the rail in the early lead. Napolitano gets the pocket early, and Go Get Lost is now parked out third. Up the backstretch, Go Get Lost now has taken the lead. Napolitano coming after him from the outside. Napolitano now taking over. Go Get Lost now yields and races second. Cotton Hanover, the early leader, is now back settled in third. The field turns for home. Napolitano holding on to a short lead. Go Get Lost is full out to stay with him. But Napolitano puts it in another gear in mid-stretch, and he's opened up now by 2.5 lengths. He's now in front by 3.5 on the inside. Cotton Hanover now driving hard in second. Go Get Lost is dropped out of it on the outside. Waikiki Beach, and they're coming to the finish, and it's going to be Napolitano to win it decisively. The final time was 1:56.
In the next round, the first five horses from each heat race again. A double win for Mac LaBelle or Napolitano will decide the title. But if another horse wins, all three must run yet again.
And here they come. For the second and perhaps deciding heat of the Hambletonian 1987, and they're off, and Waikiki Beach leaves quickly. And Mac LaBelle now takes the lead as the field moves into the turn, and Napolitano has the pocket early. Waikiki Beach and Mac LaBelle, they hook up in a speed duel down the backstretch, and Napolitano is stalking them. Third, Waikiki Beach on a break, and it's Mac LaBelle, the leader in the Hambletonian by three lengths, and Napolitano is trying to catch him as they come into the final eighth, and the others are far back. It's Mac LaBelle, and he's pouring it on. Mac LaBelle in front now by four or five. Napolitano is never going to catch him. The others are far back. Here is a brilliant trotter and a brilliant performance. Mac LaBelle has won the Hambletonian in 1:53.3, a sensational time, a new record.
Fill this up with beer. Right here, Dalvin.
The roots of harness racing lie in the chariot races of the ancient Greeks and Romans, which were the first Olympic equestrian sport. The strange notion of racing at a trot evolved in the 18th century as families trotting home tried to outdo each other. Then the British stallion Messenger came to America and started a new trotting breed of horse, the standard bred. Organized races at country fairs became popular, usually ridden, till the 1870s when the jockeys turned to gallopers, leaving trotters to pull sulkies. Somebody fell on the bay. Mounted trotting races still exist today at some European tracks, but they are notoriously difficult to ride. The sport was immensely popular in the 1800s, and in 1849, the famous Hambletonian was born, after whom the race is named. He sired 1,330 sons, and today, 95% of all American harness horses are his direct descendants. pacers now came on the scene. Unpopular at first, since it was hard for horses that broke stride to come back to a pace. Then, hobbles were invented, initially scorned, but widely adopted once they were seen to work. The best horses in the sport were celebrated animals, and none more so than Dan Patch, who raced at the turn of the century. As well as setting new records, Dan Patch drew crowds of 60,000 and became a household name along with his owner, Mr. Savage. Dan Patch gave his name to makes of toys, tobacco, dance steps, and even washing machines, as well as his own progeny. Around this time, efforts were made to improve sulky design. Sometimes ridiculous, and sometimes effective in increasing speeds. But the advent of the motor car spelt bad times for the sport, although enthusiasts continued racing undeterred. On the continent, horses even raced on the beaches.
At Germany's seaside resort of Cuxhaven, it's the Mudder's Day Stakes. Nobody's out to beat the races, they're out to beat the heat. It was just too hot to get the people to the track, so they brought the track where the people were, cooling off in the briny. And if anyone complains there's something fishy about this, makes sense.
It was not until the 1940s that the sport leapt back into prominence when pari mutuel betting was approved and night racing was instituted.
Thousands swarm into the stands every night. Crowds of 40,000 are not uncommon. Surroundings as plush as those of a big resort hotel.
The sport really took off with the invention of the mobile starting gate, under various different guises.
The field is in motion. And they're off.
There is no question that today, without the support of the betting public, the sport would hardly exist. Every major track has its own betting hall, crowded with fans on racing nights. In the States, over 30 million people attend the races each year. And on a normal night at the Meadowlands track, there are some 12,000 fans betting an average of $160 each.
Napolitano is never going to catch him. The others are far back. Here is a brilliant trotter and a brilliant performance. McLobel has won the Hamiltonian in 1:53.
In order to protect the public and the good name of the sport, harness racing around the world is governed by strict rules aimed at controlling drivers' conduct both on and off the course, and at preventing unfair use of drugs and equipment.
There are a group of us at the Meadowlands, a group of veterinarians, that are responsible for testing the horses before they race. We test their blood. Any type of drug is absolutely not permitted. Any horse that does come up positive is scratched. At the same time, there's a veterinarian examining the horses for lameness as they warm up for their heats.
Drivers are also subject to breathalyzer and urine tests before they race, and even the vets or racing officials may be called for testing without warning. All the trotting races in Europe are followed by a steward's van, which watches for breaks in stride that may be unnoticeable from the stands. As well as this, most racetracks have their own video system to film the races, which are then checked by the stewards for any untoward incidents. But neither vets nor stewards can always prevent things from going wrong. Ever since horses were first harnessed to carts, accidents have been inevitable, and the racetrack
there's a definite danger in the sport. I've been in quite a few wrecks, and I've had one knee broken, and I've had my back operated on, and I had my other knee tore up the ligaments and cartilage. It's very dangerous when there is a wreck. The trick is trying to avoid them.
Accidents usually happen when horses go on a break or as they leave the starting gate. In Australasia, where the sulkies are narrower and the racing tighter, the drivers are always rubbing hubs, and crashes occur more frequently. The first horse to break the $1 million earnings record came from New Zealand, and today Australasian horses, especially pacers, are beginning to rival their American counterparts. Janine Bowyer, one of 200 women drivers in Australia, competes against and often beats the best male drivers in the sport.
I've been in love with horses since I was about 6 years old. I can remember my father putting me on a horse, and that was the end of me.
I don't think it's a disadvantage being a woman. Originally, there was probably a little bit of harder driving towards us from the men, but definitely not now. They treat us the same as anybody else on the track. It takes a lot of mental concentration, but physically it's probably not as demanding as you might think. You'll get individual horses in the game that do require strength, but the majority of horses, it's just horsemanship, whether you can handle them or not. Some you can be a bit rough with, and others, if you did that too, you'd have no chance with them. It is an expensive sport. It's hard at times. We have to have winners, otherwise we don't survive.
Getting winners is not just a question of finding and training good horses, but of persuading them to give you everything they've got when the pressure is on. Janine's horse tonight is Minute LaBelle, whose breeding traces back to the Lana LaBelle farms in New Jersey.
I haven't had Minute LaBelle very long. She's a nice going mare, she's lovely to train. I'd like to have a stable with her manners. The start of the race, you must know what's going on around you, what the other horses can do, particularly what your own horse can do. You must know what the other drivers are like, how they drive in general. That's the whole basis of winning.
The blue light comes up, they're racing now, and out wide, Our Angel Lee, one of the fastest to begin with, Minute LaBelle and Shogun Lad, who's showing plenty of dash. And Minute LaBelle in front, by a half length on for sale. Just Kev held up for a run from Hondo, Jade Tarport Spider. but Minute Low Bell kicked at the top of the straight. It's Minute Low Bell homeward bound by two lengths on Al Angel Lee and Grand Call. Appaluka now coming to the outside to start a run. Minute Low Bell in front. Grand Call, and here's Appaluka hitting top gear. Minute Low Bell in front. Appaluka's flying home. He raced up. They hit it. Photo. Maybe Minute Low Bell, but there's not much in it.
Janine was lucky and hung onto the lead by a whisker as Minute Low Bell fought to win.
It's a great feeling winning. It's just what makes it all worthwhile.
Owners often come into this sport not for profit, but for pleasure. Tony Price, the self-styled biggest owner in Queensland, got involved in an unorthodox way.
Well, in 1974, a friend of mine convinced me to go night trotting. We were so successful on betting on the horses that evening that I decided the next day to fly down to Brisbane. I ended up buying 9 horses and a truck and took them home, and there I was, straight into trotting in a big way in an awful hurry. And I think I've been trying to get that money back ever since. I think it became an addiction, a bit like alcohol or smoking. It certainly gets into your blood. You're always chasing that elusive champion. We get plenty of heartache and a few moments of the adrenaline pumping, and I think that's what keeps you in it. I think I'd stay in it now for probably until I die.
Tony Price's trainer is Stuart Hunter, who came into the sport late and prefers to use catch drivers than race himself.
One good thing about being in this position, we can pick the best driver at the time that's in form. I've had a few drives and races, but with the owner the way he is, I wouldn't like to be driving any of his horses. He expects the best drives.
Love winning. Hate coming second. Just like winning.
Number one thing is a driver must be able to judge pace and have the patience. Most of the champion horses haven't had the same drive all the way through, and they just know exactly what that horse can do. They know when to pull that horse out to make its run. Putting a fresh driver up on a horse that he doesn't know, they might drive it upside down. Harness horses, they seem to take a lot more work than a thoroughbred horse. Most of them would jog 6 to 7 miles a day. I think there's about 16 or 18 of them racing continuously.
I had about 70 odd at one stage. They had a bad habit, they used to eat. And eating costs money. The way I usually put it is this: there's a lot of money in it. I got $1 million out of it. I started with 3 and ended up with 1.
Great efforts are made to vary the horses' routines so as not to bore them with endless jogging.
It's more of a science than the old method of hounding them around and around the track. The whole thing, a happy horse is a good horse.
We're swimming about 10 a day. Ones that swim might have a leg problem, or they're bad winded, and swimming helps their wind, and also it's a good conditioner for building up muscle. They swim anywhere between 5 and 15 minutes. First start off, it's a bit of a fight to get them in, but after they've gone in the first time, after that, they go good. They seem to enjoy it, especially in the summer we have here. They'd rather be going in there than jogging 6 or 7 miles on the track.
Swimming horses is a highly effective means of keeping them fit, popular throughout Australia, and especially with the trainers in Queensland, where the weather is hot all the year round. John McMullen's stables are in the middle of Brisbane's industrial sector. He swims his horses every day in Breakfast Creek, risking the sharks and crocodiles which have occasionally been sighted further down the creek. Swimming also enables horses with leg injuries to keep exercising without undue strain.
That horse has got a bit of a sore leg, and the vet has advised us not to jog him because it's just going to damage his leg more. And this way, he won't lose too much time.
Since they can't be turned out in paddocks, the horses in John's stables are put on the horse walker for 15 or 20 minutes every day, just to get them out of their stalls. Sprains are treated with lasers, which penetrate the injury and heal the horse in a remarkably short time. And as a standard procedure, all horses which have raced the night before or trained hard that morning are given a salt drench. This goes straight into the belly and replaces the salts or electrolytes which the horse may have lost through sweat. In complete contrast to John's urban setup are the stables of Kevin Thomas, Brisbane's leading trainer-driver. Unlike America, 90% of Australian drivers train their own horses.
It's a disadvantage if you don't train and drive, because when you're driving the horse, you know his problems, where it's hard to get a driver to tell you what's wrong with the horse if you're just a trainer.
The yearlings here are always trained in threes, which gets them used to tight racing situations right from the word go.
You try a lot of yearlings to find one that can win a race, let alone find a champion. The champion's got to be very versatile, be able to lead, be able to get parked. They're very few and far between.
Kevin will drive close to 1,000 races every year, only half the number of the top American drivers, but working for three times as many hours per day.
I wouldn't be in unless I could win. I wouldn't get up and work horses I couldn't win, that's for sure, because it's a 7-day-a-week job and you only get out of it what you put in it. You don't get home from the races until, you know, 12 to half past 12 and you've got to start again at 5, and it's not a very good life. I don't think I'd be getting up to work horses I couldn't win.
Horses can't be maintained at maximum fitness indefinitely, and the trainers must plan to make them peak for the big races. Albion Park is one of Australia's premier tracks, offering a variety of ways to enjoy the racing. The upstairs restaurant provides a gourmet buffet overlooking the track, while downstairs there are the hot dogs and bookies. In tonight's big race, one of the best bets is Tony Price's brilliant new mare, Hyperstat.
I've been talking to Stu about a better class of the horse, and I thought, well, there's no place to start at the top, so I thought I'd go and buy the best mare in Australia.
She is the best mare that's raced in the last 10 years. She's got now into the class where she races the best geldings and stallions in Australia. She must be something exceptional to be able to do that.
Kevin Thomas also has a runner in the big race, Henry Luca.
Henry Luca's a really nice horse. He's not a champion in my books because he can't lead, but he's handy to have around. We brought him as a yearling for $5,000, and he's progressed from there. He's won something like 260,000 now.
Number four, Henry Luca.
For all this, some critics maintain that Henry Luca isn't strong enough for such a big race. The clear favourite tonight is My Lightning Blue, winner of the toughest race in Australasia, the Inter Dominion. He's driven and trained by Jim O'Sullivan.
My Lightning Blue, he's got a tremendous temperament. He's got a tremendous will to win. He sort of throws himself at the line. He seems to know where the winning post is, and hopefully, in the past, he's always wanted to get there first, so hopefully he does the same thing tonight.
The track record for 1,609 metres. The starter, John Andrews, in the big yellow Cadillac is calling them up behind the arms.
Right, David, boom right up onto the gate. Keep them on the gate, no dropping off, no hanging back.
They're reaching the starting point. The blue light is on. Racing Now and My Lightning Blue was a half length off the machine when the starter said go. Run to the lead in the first turn. Talara Dream second. Hyperstat third. Henry Luca on the rail. And then Sovereign Cloud followed by Sunset Candios. Cherokee Chief. I'm a Threat second. Last and Manila Loverboy had dropped back to the tail of the field. My Lightning Blue leads by a length and a half. Sovereign Cloud three back. My Lightning Blue leads by two lengths. Talara Dream's under pressure. Hyperstat trying to get off the rail and then Paleface Bubble and Sovereign Cloud. My Lightning Blue led into the straight. Hyperstat trying to get out. My Lightning Blue in front of Hyperstat. Henry Lucas flying on the rail. Henry Lucas got up on the inside. He grabbed it. I think he won. I think Henry Lucas blows My Lightning Blue right on the line.
Henry Lucas may be no lead horse, but he can certainly sprint.
You've seen an excellent race. Horses are not machines. Horses go out, their hearts are great. They're a horse you can love, a harness horse. And those horses give it their best every time.
All over Europe, harness racing is incredibly popular, with 56,000 horses starting every year. Germany, Italy, Scandinavia, and France in particular produce some of the fastest horses in the world. Very few pacers in Europe, and the trainers take a certain pride in the extra problems involved in producing a trotter.
L'art du trotter, c'est d'aller maximum de ses possibilités dans une allure qui, au départ, n'est pas tellement la sienne, qui n'est pas une allure naturelle. D'aller maximum de sa vitesse en restant au trot, dans une allure évidemment un petit peu artificielle. Pour moi, on n'a pas besoin d'être un professionnel pour driver un pacer, parce qu'il n'y a pas d'équilibre, si vous voulez. Il suffit de leur mettre les appareils et puis bon, à cheval, il lande. Donc c'est une question de tactique un petit peu, si vous voulez, mais il n'y a pas l'art du professionnel.
Public attendance at the races is on the increase all over Europe, and even small countries like Sweden have superb racetracks and facilities. In terms of spectators, the sport here comes second only to football.
This sport is big for this small country, and we have a lot of good horses, a lot of stallions from the States. I think it's more difficult than flat racing because, you know, we have the sulky. And maybe the other drivers don't drive like you want them to do.
Torbjörn Jansson is one of Sweden's top drivers, living just outside Stockholm and running a huge operation, training 90 horses and racing 5 or 6 evenings a week.
To be good, you must have a very good horse. A good horse makes a good driver. We start to train our trotting horses when they are 1.5 year old and begin race when they are 3. And some horses race until they are 10, 11. We train month after month after month, and sometimes the horse will be good, sometimes he will be not. The most important thing is that the horse do what the driver wants to do, but if he don't have something in himself, he will never be good. It's important that they are fighters.
Mm-hmm. The 16th century Chateau of Grosbois, just outside Paris, was bought by the French Trotting Association in 1962. And today, it's the biggest trotting centre in the world, where over 50 trainers each have a yard. The facilities are magnificent. There are 3,000 metres of roadside tracks, 30 kilometres of woody avenues, and 4 circular training tracks with an additional covered track for times of bad weather. Yearlings begin their training in long reins, getting used to the harness and shafts before they ever see a sulky. Once the youngsters are broken to harness, the trainers have the invaluable benefit of a mobile starting gate. This means they can teach the horses to trot up close to the wings and make quick getaways from the start before they ever get to the races, where there will be distractions enough. It's not only the training of the horses which is so well provided for, but also their routine care. Grosbois has its own blacksmith, kept permanently busy shoeing the 1,300 horses in training every winter. An expert blacksmith is essential to get the best performance from a trotter. The angle of each horse's hoof to the ground is cut to suit his individual action, and great care is taken over the selection of the shoe. This may be made of iron, steel, aluminium, or even rubber or plastic. A heavy shoe encourages the horse to take a longer stride and assists his balance, making a break of stride less likely. But a light shoe allows him to trot slightly faster and tire less quickly. The art is to find the optimum shoe for each horse, and very often these will carry weights at the toe and heel and will vary for front and back feet. As well as a saddler's workshop, the centre has a highly impressive modern equine hospital, where racetrack injuries are treated by skilled surgeons. Pari-mutuel betting returns in France far exceed those of other European countries, and it's these returns which enable Grosbois to operate on such an impressive scale. Close to Grosbois, but preferring to run his own training operation, is champion trainer driver Jean-René Goujon.
J'ai fui l'école, je me suis fait porter malade pour quitter l'école et j'ai commencé ce métier à l'âge de 13 ans. J'ai gagné ma première course en 1941. Voilà, ça fait beaucoup d'années. Moi, j'ai pas de secret, beaucoup de travail, beaucoup de chance de rencontrer des grands champions, c'est tout, vous savez, j'ai pas de secret.
Monsieur Goujon has driven 7 or 8 champion horses in his time, but none better than the lazy, bad-tempered Ourasi, who is the current star of the 75 horses in the stables, hailed as a wonder horse throughout Europe.
Ourasi est un très très grand champion, certainement un des meilleurs que j'ai eu la chance de connaître. Mais si vous le voyez comme ça dans l'écurie et tout, vous pensez qu'il a mauvais caractère parce qu'il est toujours en train d'essayer de mordre, de jouer et tout. C'est un cheval qui est très feignant à l'entraînement, qui ne se donne jamais, simplement à la compétition. Que ce soit à l'entraînement, que ce soit dans les hits d'échauffement avant la course, c'est un cheval vraiment très très relax, et je crois d'ailleurs c'est ce qui fait sa force. Par contre, dès que nous sommes sous les ordres ou derrière l'autostar, il se tend, et là il devient le grand Ourasi que tout le monde connaît. Il se donne à fond. Il a une carrière exceptionnelle, puisqu'il a... Il a quand même remporté 22 victoires consécutives, il a gagné 2 fois le prix d'Amérique, 2 fois le critérium de vitesse de la Côte d'Azur, 2 fois le prix d'Europe, toutes les grandes courses qui puissent exister en France. Il a gagné 13 millions à l'heure actuelle, ce qui est déjà beaucoup pour un trotteur.
À 150 mètres de l'arrivée, Ourasi se détache, Ourasi possède plusieurs longueurs d'avance sur le
reste. The question that springs to mind is, when, if ever, will Ourasi take on Mac LaBelle? Although it's not impossible, travelling costs and quarantine laws mean that horses from different continents seldom meet unless they're subsequently to be sold in the new country. But efforts are being made to promote international competition, and Scandinavia is this year's host for the World Championship races, in which 10 top drivers from all over the world qualify for a week of racing in Scandinavia, with the final two races here in Sweden. The British driver qualified for this competition by coming second in the European Championships, a great boost for the sport in England and a surprise to everyone.
When we came to Europe, they've never heard of trotting in England. And to see an Englishman, they thought it was quite strange. To finish second, it was real good.
Racing rules differ slightly from country to country, and the foreign drivers have new problems to face in Scandinavia.
I only drive paces most of the time. You know, and they have hobbles on, and it's a little easier. But with these, you have to keep them balanced all the time.
We're not used to their type of racing either, because we race mile races, and these here are mile and a quarter, mile and a half, or whatever, you know, and it's just a little bit different.
Completely different our way of racing. This is the first time I've ever been without a fence, a running rail around the track.
In order to overcome the prohibitive costs and quarantine problems of transporting horses, the drivers are all supplied with horses they've never driven before by local trainers like Torbjorn Jansson. But this too creates problems, since the horses are driven much harder than usual, even when they have small chance of winning.
They just can't get the better quality horses. No one wants to have the horse knocked about, I guess.
Whoever got the best horse usually wins.
For all this, the concept of bringing these drivers together is widely supported.
It's nice to get all the countries together and meet everybody, and it's good for the sport.
It's created a lot of interest in Australia, and it's created a lot of interest around the world where the drivers' concern come from.
The clear favourite is the Norwegian Ulf Thoresen, who has a 15-point lead over the Australian Ted Demler.
The winner of the World Championship, I'm quite sure it will be Ulf Thoresen. That's because he is the best driver in the world.
I don't say that. So what the other people say, I can't stay for that.
He's driving the favourite in the first, and I've drawn bad, so it'll be interesting to see where we finish.
So with horses unknown to them, the drivers move up to the start, and they're racing. But the Canadian's horse is on a break. The Swedish horse moves out, but he's on a break now. That's two horses out of the running. And the Danish driver takes the lead. New Zealand and Macau are chasing him, with Ted Demler and Joe Marsh bringing up the rear. Ulf Thoresen is challenging the Dane now, but here comes Ted Demler, making an extraordinary run up the outside. Right into the lead. Ted Demler is still leading into the home stretch and increasing his lead with every stride as Ulf Thoresen drops way back among the stragglers. And Ted Demler wins the race decisively for Australia.
It was a pleasant surprise, you know. I'm sort of in the hot seat now.
They told me my horse was very strong. I had to push him the whole way, but it was finished after one turn, ice cold.
Ted Demler now leads by 2 points, and all is dependent on the final race of the championships. A chaotic start. Neither Ted Demler nor Ulf Thoresen were on the gate, and the Swede breaks early again. Joe Marsh moves up to take the lead, stalked by the New Zealander and the Dane. Then comes Stephen Lees for Britain. As they come up the home stretch, it's the Dane Birger Jorgensen struggling for the lead with the New Zealander Maurice McKendry. But the real fight is between Ted Demler and Ulf Thoresen, who are battling for third place and the World Championship title. And the Dane wins the race from the New Zealander, but no one can see who came in third. And the stewards are left to make the final points calculation as soon as they get the results.
Ted Demler, strong.
And Australia wins the World Championships this year. This may not be the best way of deciding a world champion, but the spirit of competition and cooperation shown throughout this international event counts for more than any medal.